Defense, thy true religion in our hearts increase. Thy bounteous goodness nourish us in peace.
Morning. Will you join me as we stand and pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America on this 4th of July weekend? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Would you please remain, well, don't, just have a seat for a second. Have a seat. Been a wild and stormy time, hasn't it? We got another storm in Frankfurt last night, which caused me to get here about 5 minutes ago. So if I'm a little discombobulated, we'll pull her all together. I want to welcome all of you, you visitors who are with us today. We're delighted to have you here today, and everyone else too. The shutters are shut because when the community choir sings in here at night, it's kind of hard with the sun pouring in their faces. Of course, lately we've had more clouds and rain than we have sun, but nonetheless, that's why the shutters are closed. The announcements, if you'll turn with me on the back of your bulletin, here's what we have. The community choir performed Friday night at the Relevant Apostolic Church in Carrollton. It was just a downright delightful time. Those folks are so hospitable up there. They were so welcoming. All the things logistically that we had to do to put a 40-member choir on their stage, sound, the camera and everything, they never said no to anything I asked for. They just said, what else can we do? What else can we do? And they had a beautiful reception. And we'll have a beautiful reception here, too. After our program, the community choir will be here tomorrow night at 7 o'clock for the second of our two programs this year. Same program we did at Relevant. This is just the first time we've been there, but we want to invite all of you who aren't in the choir to come and support this. The reception which follows, Molly and company have done it here for years. They have a whole crew up there. They made all the food up there. We didn't have to do anything, just sit down and eat. It was quite a welcoming thing. And afterwards, I'd never been to an apostolic church and got to know the minister there, and he said, come up, we'll have lunch sometime. And so I'm looking forward to getting to meet really nice guy, really nice church, and I want to just publicly thank them for their hospitality in doing this. That's tomorrow night, 7 o'clock right here. Mark your calendars. Future Planning Committee is meeting 6:30 p.m. Tuesday, June the 11th, 6:30. I'm not taking a vote of who's going to be here, who's not. I hope as many of you as can will be. We're going to talk about, as we do when we meet, things that are going on, things that we would like to see happening in the life and the work of this church. So that's a week from Tuesday. There is nothing else this week. Seekers are not meeting until the 12th. Next Noodles carry out is July the 9th. The bin is on the back downstairs table. Let's keep that full. And then Christmas is coming in July. Is going to be on the 23rd. Unfortunately, Shirley won't be here, but Chad has already agreed to be here to play. So that's a Sunday that we've celebrated for years, that we celebrate Christmas in July. We sing Christmas songs. We have a Christmas message. It's just Christmas in July. As it says here in Warsaw, Christmas comes twice a year. So that's what's going on. We welcome all of you on this 4th of July Sunday, and we hope that everyone has a blessed celebration. All of our Riverfest stuff, of course, had to be canceled because of the storm. Betty, we heard you got hit pretty hard by the storm down on your end of Warsaw. Took out the trees here behind the parsonage, or took out part of it. I can't say it's fortunate that a tree fell any direction, but the way that it fell is all the property owners behind us, and it's not our tree anyway. But the back end of that tree fell out, and it's a mighty big tree. So we hope there's not too extensive damage or physical loss. Okay, Sally?
If you'd please stand, we'll have our invocation. Dear loving God, this is the day that the Lord has made. We rejoice and are glad in it. We praise your name and thank you for the many blessings you bestow upon us. For these blessings, we give you thanks with a grateful heart. Today, we celebrate the birth of a free nation. Many men and women died fighting for those freedoms that make the USA the land of opportunity for every girl and boy, man or woman. May the songs and sounds of the 4th of July ring in each individual heart as we ponder the freedoms that we are so fortunate to enjoy. Yes, God, you do bless America, and you bless all the universe. This morning, we pray the Lord's Prayer in unison and think on its great and powerful message of hope and comfort. Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Remain standing, we will have our opening hymn, which is printed for you in the bulletin, the second verse of the Star Spangled Banner. I think everybody knows the first verse of the Star Spangled Banner, but the second verse is printed for you. Oh, say, can you see?
Sing better than the community choir. Almost as good. Thank you. Be seated. May I have the board? Shirley Warnick.
Do we have any children here today? No, that's okay. I'm going to stay where I am since we have no children. I had something in mind, and I was trying to put it down on a 4 or 5-year-old's level. And I thought, okay, I got to make this simple because they're young. And so I was looking through a box of church things, and I found something I did years ago when Cam and Kennedy, and I don't even know if Grace was in front, because if so, she was very young. And I'm going to repeat it, and I'm wondering if they will remember hearing this. So we think about the 4th of July, and I planned on asking them if they knew why we celebrate the 4th of July. Of course, it is the birthday of our nation. And we have a celebration, just like when they have birthdays. And we have parties and parades. And one of the things we do is we have fireworks. And we were going to talk about, why do we have fireworks? And it's in celebration. And you know, fireworks are pretty, but they can be dangerous. And so you have to be careful. And I planned on asking, and I was hoping there would be children here because I wanted to hear the answers, but what is this thing on top? It's called the fuse. And I wanted to know, has anyone ever heard the expression, they have a short fuse? And what does that mean? If someone has a short fuse, it means they light up really quickly and can explode, and it can be dangerous, just like a firework can be dangerous. But the Bible tells us that God is slow to anger, and so that must mean God has a long fuse, because it takes a whole lot before God can get angry. And we need to try to be like God and to have a long fuse and not explode quickly, but to think, take our time and think about things and try not to get angry quickly. So just like the fuse, we need to remember that when we're seeing fireworks go off, which there's not going to be, the fireworks were canceled because of the weather, but the next time you see fireworks, you think about that and you think, I wonder if your fuse was short or long. If they're long, they're a little bit safer because you have time to get out of the way. And like fireworks, we need to try to have a long fuse and not be quick to anger, but to be able to stay calm. And I also had some sparklers that I was going to give out for them to use with their parents or older sibling. So anyway, I'm sorry the children missed it, but they'll probably be back next week. But before we go, let's have a word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you for America and that we can celebrate the birth of our country, the land of freedom and opportunities. And God, we thank you for what you teach us in the Bible. And we hope that we can be slow to anger and not have a short fuse like some of the fireworks, but that we can always be calm and try to bring glory to you by being like you. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
I've worked my whole life not to have a short fuse, but sometimes it gets a little short. And that's a good message, Shirley. Just be patient. Don't be in too big of a hurry to react. We continue our service of worship today with our prayer hymn and then with our prayer time. All of our hymns today, as you notice, of course, are patriotic hymns. That I know that different churches believe different ways and different things, but I've always, in the churches that I served, I think America and the church are very closely intertwined. We wouldn't have one without the other. And so I think it's altogether fitting and proper, to paraphrase Lincoln, that we celebrate in this way. Our prayer hymn, My Country, 'Tis of Thee, number 721 in your hymnal, verses 1 and 4. With me again to the back of your bulletin, prayer list is there. Before we begin what we have here, we want to offer our prayers of quick healing to Benji Bledsoe, who was injured in a work accident the other day and is doing well, Angela says, and we want to continue to remember him. It was the kind of accident, as Tony explained it to me, that could have been very, 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 very bad. And we're very lucky that he was not injured any worse than he was. It was an ankle injury, and he's had surgery, and Molly and Angela went up to get him yesterday. Did he behave himself okay? Yeah, I imagine so. Okay. We want to remember Linda Robbins. Millie Proctor is the lady, she's a member of our church, who takes care of Sally Duguid. And she and Sally and Linda Robbins and their son Jay Duguid have all been in Florida for the last several months. Of course, Bill passed away 2 or 3 months ago, I guess, wasn't it, Bobby? And while there and coming back, Linda fell and took a bad fall and has got some head injuries. And Millie contacted me the other day and asked if we'd remember her in prayer. Alan Jones, is there any change there, Sally? Or okay, needs our prayers. Frank Burkhart is Lonnie Fowler's cousin. She just asked me to put him on a prayer list. Tracy Valois, Bob, anything there that's doing okay? Want to move her, take her off. And again, we want to remember the family of Vicki Payton. We don't normally put the families on twice, but I thought that it was this case. The funeral was just this week. I know many of you were there. Both of her grandchildren read, gave testimony to their grandmother. It's just incredible, the wonderful woman that passed away so quickly of cancer. Is there anyone else that we would add to the prayer list? This time, of course, we want to remember the United States of America as we celebrate our 247th birthday. And when you consider that this church is 187 years old, we're right there with it, so we're not too far off. May we bow for a moment of silent meditation. Our Father, God, we have so much to be grateful for today. Even with the face of the challenges that we are experiencing in our country, and we've always experienced challenges. Indeed, where two or three are gathered together in your name, in your Son's name, you are there among them. It seems that where two or three Americans are gathered together, there may be some kind of disagreement about one thing or another. As long as we can, as the late Skip Smith used to say, agree to disagree agreeably, then that's fine, because that's the lifeblood of a church, a nation, a family, whatever it may be. That's how we get along. That's how we work things out. That's the way we have to do it. We pray, O God, as our nation faces struggles today, that we can manage to once again become united. Seems that we have become different in our feelings and the way that we look at things sometimes. But this is a good time. A birthday is a good time to celebrate our shared heritage. One of the things that our community choir sings is great anthem called Different Backgrounds. And it talks about how all of us, everyone in this nation, comes from some sort of a different background, a different place. If we trace our ancestry back far enough, we know that there are people of different colors, of different creeds, of different backgrounds, of different faiths. What makes America what it is? great melting pot of the world. We thank you for that, O God. We accept that challenge, at least we should, that everyone is not the same, that everyone doesn't need to be the same in order to be accomplishing, to get along. You sent your Son into this world, into a disparate situation that called for unity, but called for someone who could give a clear message to the people of that day. You had tried other ways to reach your people that had not worked. You tried this one. Instead of turning to the people and saying, I'm going to punish you, you turned to them in love and said, I'm going to show you love. And in so doing, sent your Son to this earth, offering him up his very life that your message might be shared. And the message that he shared is one that we share here at our church, one that we share often from this pulpit. That when asked, what is the greatest commandment? He responded to those asking that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul. And he paused and said, and the second is like unto it, to love your neighbor as yourself. That was the message that Jesus brought. And for those of us who call ourselves Christians, that's the message we need to hear. Doesn't matter what our denomination is, doesn't matter how our beliefs differ, we can all live and work together for your glory on this earth. We pray your blessings upon those whose names we have mentioned here and added to the prayer list. We thank you that you are there to be support and a healer too, particularly in times of loss, as we seem to have experienced so much here lately in our community, that your peace can descend upon those who remain and help them through all of their struggles. Bless us all in our journeys. Thank you for bringing us together. It's in his name that we ask it. Amen. Our soloist again.
I had not heard, and last year, my sister, who lives in South Carolina, she mailed me a copy of it and said, I think you will like this song. You can use it next year. Well, I didn't know it, but it's actually in our hymn book, and it's called This Is My Song. The words are beautiful, so listen as they do a good job singing this for us.
This is my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for lands afar and mine. This is my home, the country where my heart is. Here are my hopes, my dreams, my hope. But other hearts in other lands are beating with hopes and dreams as true and high as mine. My country's skies are bluer than the ocean, and sunlight beams on clover leaf and pine. But other lands have sunlight too and clover, and skies are everywhere as blue as mine. So hear my song, O God of all the nations, a song is my prayer, O God of all earth's kingdoms. Your kingdom come, on earth your will be done. O God, be lifted up till all are viewed.
Program. Of course, as usual, I forgot birthdays, so we want to back up and do that. Tanya Smith, you got a birthday? She's a grinning. Wednesday, right? Colby Carlton has got a birthday. Our Hansen coming up. So, Shirley, let's do a round of birthday. I'll ask you how old you are, but that's all right. Tony's flashing signals. I lost count there. It's okay, whatever it is we years ago had a 50th birthday party for me, and I do mean years ago, and a guy in the church at that point made these pins that said, "I'm younger than Phil Case." And a lot of people in Frank that came to that party still have their pins. And I said, "I want you to see my pin. It says, I'm younger than Phil Case." And there were a lot of people there that were. So, you know, you're younger than Phil Case. So that's what you, that we're glad to have that. So we turn our attention to Independence and Independence Day. We can be extremely sure that our Bible never mentioned the American 4th of July celebration. That's pretty obvious, isn't it? Because even the youngest books in the Bible, meaning that the ones that were written last, it was still 1,400 years before America would be discovered. It was still a long time off. So this was not anything in here about American independence or anything like that. But you can be sure that in this book, independence is mentioned often. Independence is mentioned a whole lot, right there with freedom. Because the theme of this is not just physical independence and freedom, but spiritual independence and freedom. First passage of scripture that I want to read comes from the little book of Peter, the letter of Peter, the second chapter of that book, and I want to read a couple of verses. The second chapter beginning with the 16th. Live as free men, and we'll say free people. We know that different translations, this is everybody, not just men. You women live as free too. We want you, you know, it's more like you live as free and we follow what you say. Live as free men, yet without using your freedom as a pretext for evil. Now listen to what the writer is saying here. Without using your freedom as a pretext for evil, but love as servants of God. Honor all, love the brotherhood, fear God, and my translation says honor the emperor. We don't have an emperor, so we'll won't have to do that, but honor the emperor. Again, let me read it without commentary. Live as free people, yet without using your freedom as a pretext for evil. Live as servants of God. Honor all. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the emperor. Pretty clear, isn't it? It's pretty clear. This was written long, long, long before our country was ever came into being. But on this Sunday that we celebrate our 247th birthday, we hear that message as just as powerful as it was when it was given. It packs the same message to us in freedom as when it was given. We think about all the things that we know and have heard about the beginning of the United States, the Declaration of Independence, Independence Hall, the excitement of all of that. So much of that has been shrouded in songs and celebrations and everything now that we're a long, long way from where we were in those years 247 of them ago. It was not an easy time. How do you break away from the country that gave you birth? How do you do that? I want to read a little bit from, this is from the narration that those of you who can or have or will come to from the that's used with the community choirs program. This is the some of the narration from that. First of all is the preamble to the Constitution. The Constitution of the United States is a document that guides us, and we hear about it all the time. All the time. What did the Constitution say? How do we interpret that? There's a whole cadre. I guess, Spike, you probably had more than one class in law school on constitutional law. A whole lot, because that's what our basis is. That's where we are. The base of our democracy. Signed in September the 17th of 1787. By 38 of the 41 delegates who were present at the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. And it begins with these words. These are the words which guide us in our country. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, and many of us learned this in school, didn't we? We learned these words. This was part of what our education was about, to memorize these things. In order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. That simply. When you see a copy of the Constitution, that's right at the top. Preamble of the Constitution. That's how it began. Now, one of the things that we want to remember, too, is whether it's our faith, whether it's our nation, whether it's anything that's important to us, nothing is ever done without sacrifice. There has to be sacrifice that goes along with it, giving up of something. America was built, and I read these words to you, and sustained on sacrifice. Those who signed the Declaration of Independence hardly went on to live lives of ease. Maybe you've heard this, because I think this is very important for us to hear at this time. Us here, you out there, maybe someone hasn't heard it. Here's what happened to them. The 56 men who signed the Declaration were not token patriots when they pledged their lives and honor to the cause of freedom. The average age was 44, and the youngest was 26. Ben Franklin was the oldest at 70. Most had money. None were hungry. None were out of work. They actually laid their lives and fortunes on the line for freedom. Of the 56, here's what happened. Five were arrested by the British as traitors. 12 had their homes looted and burned. 2 lost sons in the war. 17 lost their fortunes. 9 fought in the war and died. 3 who signed the Declaration lived to be over 90. 10 passed 80. 11 past 70. So it wasn't march down the street and wave the flag and the band play 76 trombones. When they said our life, liberty, and our pursuit, they pledged themselves. When they pledged themselves, they meant it. They came from all walks of life. 24 were lawyers, not surprisingly, since it had to do with law. 14 were farmers. 4 were doctors. 9 merchants, and my profession was represented by one minister who was at this signing. 3 were born in Ireland, 2 in England and Scotland, 1 in Wales. During the war, they were offered immunity to come back to the British cause, but none did. We could read on to what happened to them. Some lived lives of great political service, some did not. But they were willing to do this to capture, in reality, what freedom meant. That's what we're talking about. Freedom has always been something that has been important to people. First of all, the freedom of the body. The freedom of the body. Your body. Did you choose to come here today, or did somebody make you do it? Was there anyone on the edge of town that stopped you and said, where are you going today? Unless you were speeding. I sometimes wonder. So I keep my Bible handy, and I say, well, I'm the preacher at the Warsaw Christian Church. And they say, oh, well, that's all right. I hate to give a minister a ticket. That's really happened. That's happened. But nobody stopped you, did they? There was nobody standing at the street corner, nobody at the edge of town. Where are you going? Well, I don't think you ought to go there. Freedom of the body to move about. Throughout the scriptures, men, women, boys, girls, nations have looked for freedom. Go clear back into the book of Exodus, the story of the people of God that were being enslaved in Egypt at that time. Beautiful story. This story is found entirely in the 12th chapter of Exodus. I'm not going to read that to you today. But they were held in captivity and they wanted to be free. And Moses had gone and they tried everything to talk Pharaoh into saying, just open up the gates, let them go. Let them go back to their homeland. Pharaoh said no. Until finally Moses came and said, all right, you've called this down upon yourself. And the angel of death passed through, and the firstborn in every family was taken. Well, this included Pharaoh's family. When that happened, Pharaoh said, get them out of here. I'm tired of fooling with them. It took that kind of desperate thing, it took that in order to get the attention of the great leader Pharaoh to let the people go, because they wanted freedom of the body. They wanted to be able to go do what they were called to do in the service of God, to return to their homeland, their promised land. That's what they wanted to do. But they couldn't do that freely. My mother used to always talk about, well, not always. She talked all the time, but it wasn't always about this. That's where I got that trait. She used to say one of the things that she said when you talk about what was going on in the world then, and this was back in the 50s and 60s, she would say, that's just another example of man's inhumanity to man, of what people do to other people in order to exert their will on them. Freedom of the mind is second. Freedom of the mind to think as we will and as we choose. We don't all think alike. We don't all interpret this book alike. We don't all do the same things alike. But we have in our minds the freedom to be able to say and to do what it is that we want to do without infringing upon someone else. That's the important thing, too. What you think is important, what I think is important. What you think is not more important than I think, nor what I think is it more important than what you think. I'd hate to say that six times, but you get the idea. Nothing is more important than what anyone else says. It's important for us to be able to say what's important to us and to say it with some enthusiasm and say, this is where I stand. In the Gospel according to Matthew, and Sarah, I apologize, you didn't get all of these verses for putting up on the live stream. Matthew 16. Jesus is warning his disciples, Matthew 16, 15 through 17. He's 17. He's talking to his disciples, Matthew, for those who are looking, 16, 15 through 17. He's asking his disciples, who do people say that I am? Their minds, their voices, how do they interpret the message that I'm giving? Some of the disciples said, oh, they say you're Elijah. They say you're one of the prophets. They're saying you this, you're that. They are saying, the church I once served, that one of the common things that was often said at the board meeting if there was a complaint, someone would say, some of them are saying. Some of them were asking about. Some of them wanted to know. Finally, one day in my quiet little way, I held up my hand and I said, could I ask, who is some of them? Who's some of them? That's what Jesus is saying. Okay, who's some of them? I want to know what you think. Who do you think that I am? And Peter, in his wonderful and impetuous way, jumps up and said, You are the Christ, the Son of the living God, to which Jesus responded, Blessed are you, Peter. You are the rock on which I will build the church. That's what he said. That's what we need to say. We have the freedom of mind to say what we need to say and to feel that we say it in that fashion. Finally, the freedom of spirit. In John chapter 8, verse 31. John chapter 8, verse 31. I want to read this little passage for you. John chapter 8, verse 31. I have it marked with my pink ribbon. They're always handy to have. John chapter 8, verse 31, following along there just a little bit. Jesus said to them, to the Jews who believed in him, If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. There's the key right there. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, We are descendants of Abraham and have never been in bondage to anyone. How is it that you are saying we will be made free? What he was saying was they will be made free in the spirit. They will be made free in the spirit. They weren't talking. Normally, the way when Jesus said something, someone took it differently than what he meant. That's what he meant. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. On this day, this weekend, Shirley talks about fireworks, long fuses, short fuses, Roman candles, sparklers, all of the things that we're not going to get to see here this weekend because of the tremendous storm that we had last week. And Betty, our best wishes go out to you and the damage that you experienced. And I know it seemed like it struck Warsaw and on up the road worse than it did other places. When we are thinking about this weekend and what it means, this is important for us to remember the freedoms that we have that we don't take for granted. That we don't take these freedoms for granted. That we make a moment, we take a time to remember freedom and independence, and we make it a part of the body of our existence. May we bow in prayer. Our Father God, we thank you for everything that you give us. Mainly for our minds, mainly for our spirit that we can question and we can ask. You are our great leader. Jesus interpreted what you had said. Help us, O God, to be people who care about others, to keep the spirit of this great nation alive, that we understand that no one person or no one group has the right answer all the time. No one has the right to tell us it's the right answer, that we must decide on our own, for that's what the freedom that we experience is about. May it ever be so. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Our hymn of invitation this morning and our hymn to join together here at the table is, what I find it, hymn number 705. 705, mine eyes have seen the glory. Do we have verses on that, Shirley? 705. Let's stand and sing all the verses.
Thank you.
Choir concludes our program. This is also the Battle Hymn of the Republic. I didn't even realize it was in our book with another title. This is what we conclude with. My goodness, I wish that you could, I hope you can share that with us tomorrow night here. But the other night, the people just rose up, and it was just incredible to hear 160 people singing this at the top of their voices. This message of this great hymn. Sally?
We come to the time where we gather around the Lord's table. Each and every one of you here and at home are invited to participate in the Lord's Supper. Makes no difference what emblems you use. We all have different emblems to use. Here we have bread and grape juice. And you have your own emblems there with you. There are no stipulations. You have the choice to participate in the Lord's Supper, and that invitation is open to everyone. Can we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Dear loving God, as we do gather around the Lord's table, let us focus on Jesus' many sacrifices he made for us. For many, we have lots of freedoms because of Jesus. I know we talked about freedoms today. Jesus also offered us many freedoms. And this is a freedom that we have right here, the Lord's Supper. In all our prayers, we pray that thy will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. And on that night, when Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room, he took the bread, and he broke it, and he blessed it. And he passed it among his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us take the bread of heaven together and remember Jesus. And in like manner, Jesus took the cup, and he passed it among his disciples, saying, "Take, drink, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And remember, as often as you eat the bread and you do drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us take the fruit of the vine together and remember Jesus. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear loving God, as we go forth from this beautiful sanctuary today, we have heard some wonderful songs today, a wonderful message, light in our hearts. Let us go through this week. And let this communion that we just received, we partook together, let this communion be souls, food for our souls as we go out and we do our service to you. In all our prayers, we pray that thy will be done. In Jesus' name, amen.
And for the benediction, and remember, this is the shake time to be sure that everybody greets each other, since we don't do that at the beginning of the service anymore. Hope that you can come tomorrow night, those of you that are in town and able to do so. I know many of our folks got this reception. We'd be glad to see you. A lot of work has gone into this. The choir's worked really hard on it. I'm proud of the group. It was born right here in this church, as you know, and this is the first year that we've managed to reach 40 members, which is a challenge in a community our size, but we're drawing from Carroll, Trimble, Grant, and other counties too. So it's a part of our community. We're just honored to be able to host it. May we pray. Our Father God, on this 4th of July weekend, this Independence Day weekend, help us to remember why we are free, why we are here, who we are, and it's because of you. In your name we ask it. Amen.